Hello students, welcome to the second lecture on advanced calculus. In this lecture, we are going through some basic things. That is the limit of function of one variable, function of limit for the function of two variables. So before moving on to the limit, we recap certain elementary things which you must know here that. In your lower classes, you have already done this mod of x. Mod of x is equal to either it is equal to x or it will be equal to minus x. So, x if x is greater than or equal to 0, minus x if x is less than 0. Now, if we are writing x minus l mod less than or equal to t. L is any number and t is any number. It means x lies between L minus t and L plus t. Or you can say x belongs to this closed interval L minus t to L plus t. That means if we are having L here and we are adding t to this and we are subtracting t from this, then the closed interval means including these points. So x is in this part. So it means similarly, when x minus L mod strictly less than t, then we can say x strictly lies between L minus t to L plus t. And in fact, in that case, it will be the open interval L minus t to L plus t. That means the endpoints will not be included in this situation, that x belongs to open interval L minus t to L plus t. Now if we are writing 0 less than x minus L mod less than t, it means x lies in the deleted neighborhood of L. That means if we include from this, we are deleting the points, we are deleting this point L. Suppose L is here and this is L plus t, and here L minus t. So this point will be excluded. This point will be excluded. That means x belongs to either this part or this part. L will not be there. So this is the meaning of these four elementary things. Then we move on to the bounded function. When do we say that a function is bounded? If there is a constant m such that fx is less than or equal to m for all x in any interval or any set of real numbers, we say that f is bounded above. We say that f is bounded above in that interval. And here m is called the upper bound of the function. Now, if there exists another constant small m such that fx is greater than or equal to this m for all x in the interval, then we say that fx is bounded below and m is called the lower bound of the function. Now, if a function have lower bound as well as upper bound, then we say that function is bounded. Function is bounded. Or frequently, we wish to indicate a function is bounded, then we can write that mod of fx is less than p. As explained in the very first slide, that it means fx lies between p to minus p. You can call this as small m. In place of this, you can call it as capital M. And this is fx less than this. So that is, fx is satisfying the definition of boundness here. So a bounded function can also be written like this, fx mod less than p. And sometimes it can be written as fx mod less than equal to p. There are certain examples of a bounded function. Suppose you have a function fx equal to 3 plus x. It is bounded in the interval. Whenever x is lying between minus 1 to 1 in the interval, in fact, this x is lying in the interval minus 1 to 1, then fx is bounded, because the minimum value here, if you put here x is minus 1 in this situation, this becomes f of minus 1 equal to 3. In place of x, you are writing minus 1, so that is equal to 2. Now, if we write here 1, then that is equal to 3 plus 1 equal to 4. So, in fact, the minimum value of the function is 2 and maximum value is 4. So, here we can see that this fx, value of fx, lies between 2 to 4. So, this is in fact a small m, you can say, and this is capital M. So, that is how the definition of boundedness of a function is satisfied. Now, if we talk about the lower bound and the upper bound, as here m is called the upper bound, and in this case here small m is called the lower bound. So if we talk about the lower bound and upper bound of the function fx, then 2 is the lower bound and 4 is the upper bound. But there, if I write here in place of 4, if I write 5, if I write here 1, then 5 and 1 are also the lower bound and the upper bound respectively. A function can have an infinite number of lower bounds and infinite number of upper bounds. So a number which is least among the upper bounds is called the least upper bound. That is called the least upper bound. And the number which is greatest among all the upper bounds is called the greatest lower bound. So these are the terminologies here. Similarly, the second example here, if we are writing fx equal to 1 by x, this is not bounded in the interval. This, why? This is the reason. If you are choosing something very close to 0, then definitely fx is very large, number is very large, you cannot have a fixed value so that fx can be smaller than that or greater than that. But if you are writing the upper value of x here, if you are writing 1 by 4 is the lower limit, means this function will consider the value if you are writing, because function is 1 by x. If you write x equal to 4, so this f of 4 equal to 1 by 4, that is 0.25. So in fact, when you are writing 4, this is 0, and when you are writing 4, the value of the function is something here, like this is around 0.25 or 1 by 4. At 4, the value of function is 1 by 4, but as soon as you are moving closer to 0, the values of the function goes on increasing, and when you are at 0, it is almost infinity, and it will go upward and upward. So there is no upper value of the function you cannot consider, because when x is 0 here, so 1 by 0 is infinity. So that is how it has no upper bound, but it has the lower bound. The lower bound of the function is 1 by 4. Now the monotonic function. What is a monotonic function? Look at this. What is a monotonic function? A function either monotonically increasing or it can be monotonically decreasing. Monotonically increasing means a function, if I represent it graphically, increasing means the function increases like this, and decreasing means the function decreases like this. And it is not necessary that we are decreasing like this. It can happen that the function is decreasing here like this, and so on and so forth. It can be in the negative side also. So this is decreasing function and this is increasing function, and it is monotonically increasing. Okay, whenever x1 is here and x2 is here, x1 is here and x2 is here, definitely x1 is less than x2, and consequently the value corresponding to f of x1, definitely the value of f of x1 here is this one, and f of x2 is here, f of x2. So whenever x1 is less than x2, f of x1 is less than f of x2. So in such a situation, function is monotonically increasing. If x1 is less than s2, then f of x1 is less than or equal to this. Similarly, it is strictly increasing. If monotonically means equality may also appear, but in strictly increasing function, you will have strict inequality. Fx is strictly less than f of x2. Now, similarly, for monotonic decreasing function, the case reverses. You can easily see here, if x1 is here, if this is x1 and here is x2, then definitely when x1 is less than x2, but f of x1 is greater than or equal to f of x2. So in such a case, function is monotonic decreasing, and similarly the case of strictly decreasing function. Case of strictly decreasing function. Now come to the limit of a function of one variable. Function of a one variable. So what is the meaning of limit of a function of one variable? I will try to explain it here. Let fx be defined and single valued for all values x near x equal to x naught. We say that the number L is the limit of function fx as x approaches to x naught, and we can write limit x tends to x naught fx equal to L. If for any positive number epsilon, however small, we can find some positive number delta, usually depending on epsilon, so that f of x minus L mod less than epsilon, whenever x, this x lies in the deleted neighborhood, this one. In such case, we also say that fx approaches to L as x approaches to x naught, and it can be written as fx tends to L as x tends to x naught. In other words, it means that we can make fx arbitrarily close to L by choosing x sufficiently close to x naught. So this is the epsilon delta definition of limit of a function. Graphically, you can look at the situation. Actually, what we have defined here, that fx, the limit of function fx is L if this quantity is less than epsilon. Whenever this x minus x naught less than delta less than here 0 in the deleted neighborhood. So in deleted neighborhood means we are excluding the point x naught over here, and we are also excluding the end points x naught plus this. So if L is the limit of the function, if the value of fx, if value of fx lies in this part, means L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon, whenever this x naught lies in the interval x naught minus delta to x naught plus delta, that means what is happening here, x approaches to x naught, limit of fx when x approaches to x naught equal to L. So either we can write it in this manner, or epsilon delta definition of the function is here. Note one thing, this epsilon and delta, these varies depending upon this, depending on the situation. For example, if we are having a function whose graph is like this, then you can see the limit of the function is L when this x tends to m, when x tends to m. If we are considering m here, if we are considering m here, then in that situation, it is not, limit is not L because the function is going outside. But if we are considering m here, we are considering m here and in the small neighborhood delta up to this place, not here, up to this place, very small m minus delta you have to choose, and also in this side you have to choose m plus delta. So basically this delta is depending on this epsilon, where the limit you are going to choose. If you increase it here, that this is L plus epsilon here, and here L minus epsilon. Now the strip, got broadened. And now you can see whatever delta you can choose, you can increase that value of delta here to here. So everywhere the limit again will be in this part. The limit will be L for this epsilon. That means epsilon increases. When you increase the epsilon, the value of delta also increases. But when you are limiting the value of epsilon here, the value of delta is also limited too. Next, the right hand and the left hand limits. You just understand this in graphically. I explain. You can read the definition here. Suppose we are at this point x naught, and let this is the graph of the function fx, and let L is the limit here, then this is L plus epsilon, and let this is L minus epsilon. So let we are taking the strip here. Now x can approach, now we have two direction, x can approach to x naught either from this side or from this side. So when x naught is approached from the right hand side, then definitely value of x will be x naught plus something, very small thing. And when x naught is approached from the right left hand side, then x tends to x naught minus, it will be x naught minus very small thing. So now it is approached from left hand side. So when this situation occurs, then we see the limit is the left hand limit, and when we it is approached from right hand side, then limit is called the right hand limit. You can see this is the left hand limit if we are writing like this, and this is the right hand limit, and this is the left hand limit. Any limit of a function exists. Remember this thing, very important thing. The limit of a function exists if and only if left hand limit, right hand limit equal to left hand limit equal to L. The limit of a function fx said to be L as x tends to x naught if and only if the right hand limit equal to left hand limit equal to L. So remember this thing. The similar situation holds in the function of two variables. We are discussing this left concept of left and right limit because in your course we have the limits and continuity of a function of two variables. So this concept should be clear. Whenever we are discussing the concept of limit, then that limit, that particular point can be approached either from left side or from the right side. And left hand limit and right hand limit, if both are equal, only then we can say the limit of the function exists. Now let us move on to the limit of function of two variables. So you can see, as I have already discussed in lecture one, that a function of one variable is a curve in two dimension, and a function of three variables is a surface. It is a surface, maybe like this. This is not the exact situation here. I'm just assuming that it is going to give you this type of shape. This function is going to give you this situation. Now we want to check whether the limit of this function exists or not. Limit xy tends to 0, 0, f xy, whether this limit exists or not, we want to check it. Now as in case of the function of one variable, one particular point x naught could be approached either from left side or from right side, because we have only one line. Let this is x-axis and this is origin and this is y-axis. So x naught can be approached either from left hand side or from the right hand side. But in case of curve, in case of this function of two variables, if we want to approach any point, you can see this is the case of three dimensions. So in fact, we are having a plane. We are having the xy plane. We are having this xy plane. And if we have a point in xy plane, it can be of the form that point is here x naught y naught. So this x naught y naught, this x naught y naught can be approached from any direction. This x naught y naught can be approached from any direction. For example, if we are having a point xy in general in the plane, suppose we are having any point in general in xy plane, xy, the general point. This point x naught y naught can be approached either through this path, it can be approached through a straight line, it can be approached through a path, random path like this. So there are infinite number of possibilities through which this path, this particular point can be approached. The main point is that the limit of this function, the limit of this function exists. If I say limit f of xy, where this xy approaches to x naught y naught equal to L. This exists if x naught y naught can be approached from any of the direction along any of the path, the value comes out to be same. In case of one variable, we can approach this x naught, we can approach this x naught either from left or from right, either from left or from right, because this is on a line. So limit exists if left hand limit equal to right hand limit. In this situation, the limit exists if we can approach this x naught y naught by any of the, through any of the path from in any of the direction. So this is the main concept here to remember. Let us see. Suppose in this example, you see at xy, we want to find, we want to check the existence of the limit of this function f of xy equal to this when xy tends to 0, 0. That means the point 0, 0 is being approached. That means this point 0, 0 is approached. Xy is somewhere in the plane. This is in the plane. So this is approached from in any of the direction. Let us see. Suppose if this point is approached along x-axis. Along x-axis means this is x-axis. When along x-axis, you know y equal to 0. So when this point is approached along x-axis, then definitely y equal to 0. And when we put in this case y equal to 0, so we get xy x equal to 1. So limit comes out to be 1. Now if we approach along y-axis means this is y-axis here, and along when we are approaching this along y-axis, the value of x is 0. But when you put x equal to 0, then it come out to be 0. Now here you can see easily that if we are approaching this point 0, 0 along two different paths, the value of limit comes out to be different. So therefore, we can say the limit of this function does not exist. Similarly, in the second example, you can see in fact, this is the graph of this function. In the second example, we can see this one. We again check the limit when xy approaches to 0, 0. Again, in this case, limit of the function when xy approaches to 0, 0. Again, we are applying the same logic. When we are approaching it along x-axis, this is 0. When we are approaching along y-axis, again it is 0. So what happens if we are approaching it along some different path? That means the situation is like that. In this case, we have the exact curve. When we are approaching, because in fact you can see here, this is your y-axis and this is x-axis, and x and y are 0 means the axis are passing somewhere here, and like that this is the z-axis. So somewhere here is the origin, because below these are the negative value and above this are positive values. So this is somewhere in middle, this point. And when this point is approached, this point 0, 0 is approached through different different paths or different directions. Then what happens, you can see, if we are writing here, this is the 0, 0. And if it's approached along different directions, that means first we were approaching it along x axis and y axis, the value comes out to be 0. F of x, y comes out to be 0, the limit of this. But when we are approaching it along the path y equal to x, y equal to x is a line of this type. If we are having this x axis, y axis, then y x equal to is the line this passing through origin and at the angle 45 degree. So if we are approaching this along such line y equal to x, then what is happening in this situation? In this situation, you can see when we are writing y equal to x here, this is x square. So x square by 2x square, this goes with this. We are having 1 by 2. So we can see if we are approaching the point 0, 0 along x axis, we are getting 0. When we are approaching along y axis, we are getting 0. But when we are approaching along the line y equal to x, we are getting 1 by 2. So we can say that the limit does not exist. Similarly, the next example here you can also check the limit. We are approaching along x-axis, we are getting 0. When we are approaching along y-axis, getting 0. But when we are approaching along this, we are getting this type of the function. And as x approaches to 0, we can have limit x tend to 0, this is equal to 0. So in such situations, we have to proceed in some different manner. Let us see, when we are approaching here along the line y equal to x, what happens when you are writing y equal to x here? So this is x cube here, x4, and here x square. So we have already done this. So again, this is getting, we are getting 0. But next we consider another curve, y equal to x square. When we are writing y equal to x square here, then this is 1 by 2. So now we are getting the different value of the function f of x, y. When this x 0, 0 is approached along the curve y equal to x square. So this way we are not getting all the limits are same, so that we can say limit of this function does not exist. And this is the exact curve for this function. Now you can solve these examples. So I have written these, the example 1, exercise 1, exercise 2, exercise 3, 4. In the same manner, you can check the limit of this function exist or not. You can try this yourself. These are certain references. Thank you.